you know, the oils I put in. I make up like a flu shot oils that.
Here, let me just sit up here.
I think I got a bottle of NyQuil locust tonight. I really need it.
Freddie, the you know the Santa riverbed?
Mm-hmm.
There's more and more homeless people. I mean, it's getting really bad. Really.
That's bad. Not good.
I mean, it's just mold to farge. Yeah. Well, yeah, by Chapman. And then if you go along the freeway when you get out, you have to see more all the way. All the way along the off ramp.
They're not down my way. Huntington Congo.
Okay, guys, let's. Let's start with prayer. I know Raphael is waiting, huh, Raphael? Yeah. Our official start time, I don't know if you know, is 7:15. I've adjusted it because of it takes a little long for my commuting here and then setting up. So that's about right. But we're still a little late. So let's start with prayer and we'll look at Revelation. Father, thank you as always for bringing us together safely so that we can know you more through your word. We fellowship with thee, which then allows us to have fellowship with each other. And Lord, for those that are on their way, we ask for traveling mercy so that they too can benefit from the intake of thy word. And Lord, if we've committed any sins, we name them to you in the privacy of our hearts, knowing full well that you'll forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So thank you, Father, for this time, and we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. All right, we're on Revelation chapter 3, and we're looking at verse 21.
Wow,
we're already on chapter 3. Yeah, we're on 3:21. I'm sorry, maybe it's 2:21.
We're still on 2?
Yes, that's right. We were off for a few months.
Yeah.
So, and then so on 21, this is where we left off, you'll recall. This is to the church at Thyatira. And when you look at verse 19, it was a church that was commended for her works, her love, her service, her faith, and patience. And for your works, the last are more than the first. And then when we get to 21, there's sexual immorality. I gave her time to repent of her sexual immorality, and she did not repent. And the word, remember, repent means to turn in the opposite direction or to change one's mind. And the primary idea behind this word is to change, is change of thinking. And I had pointed out last week as well that this seems to indicate that this person, this prophetess who goes by the name of Jezebel, whether that's her actual name or just a way to kind of give an idea as far as what she was doing. Because the word repent is used, to me it seems like this person was a believer. Because the word repent, for the majority of the times that it's used in the New Testament, it's used primarily for believers in God. So we don't ask unbelievers to turn back to God because they never started with God, right? So if the word repent is there, then it's the idea of changing and reorienting back to truth or back to God. So I gave her time, and last week I had pointed out that because it says her time, I gave her time, it seems like that God was very patient. So here's a woman who was seducing and getting God's workers to fall into sin and even to take part in the, and we'll see that there were some foods, meats that were sacrificed to idols, and they were apparently they were taking part in that as well. So this idea of patience, God is always patient. It's clearly seen in verse 21. So regardless of the sin, he is interested in the sinner. Everybody is a candidate for God's grace and God's patience. And when we see verses like this, we should be quick to remember that when someone is in need of forgiveness, we ought to extend that forgiveness as well, right? So there's patience that's involved. God is very patient. And the sin today, this day and age, this might be a grievous sin. This might be a sin that may be frowned upon in some churches, and in other churches it's not really a big deal. But we do know that just in this one verse alone, God was very patient. I gave her time to change her mind, to reorient to truth, to come back to me, and to stop doing the immorality as found in 21. And guess what happened? Well, she didn't repent. She continued. Jezebel remained stubborn in her doctrine. It was her teaching where this sexual immorality was a part of this new teaching that she was promoting, which included partaking in the sacrifices that were given to the idols. So in her stubbornness, she failed to repent. So what can we conclude with that? She's definitely in carnality. If she is governed by her sin nature, then there's probably nothing that she can do. There's probably no way for her to recover from this, because she's waddling in the sin. She's steeped in her teachings that go contrary to the scripture. And so God was patient, and yet, according to 21, the very tail end, she did not repent. God is waiting for her to repent. God waits, and in principle for us today, he waits for us to repent. He's very patient with us, just as he's patient with this one particular woman here. But she didn't repent, and hopefully that's not the case with us, right? When we commit sin, if it's a moment's time, what do? We confess it. And if it's a lifestyle, we repent. Remember the distinction between the two? Notice that she's not asked to confess her sin, because it didn't just catch her off guard. If we had a bad or a fleeting thought, or we said something we shouldn't have said, or someone cuts us off and we want to chase them down, and then after the chase, we pull off, they pull off, and then we say, oh, I shouldn't have done that. I endangered people, and that was not appropriate for me as a representative of God. Lord, that was wrong. I confess that to you. That is definitely something I shouldn't be doing, and I know better. That's confession. When you are away from God, where it's an ongoing lifestyle for days and days at a time, you're no longer asked to confess. You don't need confession, because number one, you won't. You're just too calloused. You're too focused on your own thing to worry about confessing to God. So God will many times, or sometimes, orchestrate particular details in your life to finally get and capture your attention, so that you'll go on your knees and say, I was wrong. And then you go back towards God. And although God is omnipresent, the idea there is that when we repent, we reorient and we know better, we go back to church, we go back to studying the scriptures, we go back into our prayer mode, because when we stay away from those things, we have a tendency to default to our old sin nature, our old ways. Remember, you're very good at sinning. We're all experts in sinning. There's tendencies within our nature. Each one of us are different. Some of us have strengths that might be your weakness, and some of you have strengths that might be my weakness. But whatever the case may be, the ability to say no or to walk away from that isn't generated by willpower. It's under the governing influence of God the Holy Spirit. If we walk by means of the Spirit, we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So as we remove ourselves from the place of feed, meaning if you take yourself away from the intake of God's Word, whether it's a Bible study, home Bible study, church, or any of the, anything that would deliver content, deliver His Word, then you're shortchanging yourself, because that'd be the equivalent to not eating and not consuming food. So you need to partake in food. You study the Bible. If you can do that consistently, good. But the reality is that a lot of people don't have time. They're not that committed to really getting into the Word without being distracted by their cell phone, a text message. Oh yeah, I've got to email this person, and a list of things just continue to crowd out the priority of God and His Word. So likewise, when she was, the one thing we do know about her is she was in sin, and there is a particular doctrine or teaching that she was promoting. So that whole thing will keep you away from God's Word. If you're wrapped up or caught up in a teaching that goes contrary to Scripture, then of course you're not going to have any time for the Scripture. You're not going to have any time for His Word. So she remained stubborn. God was patient. She didn't repent. She continued to commit sin and encourage His people, His leaders, to sin in the immorality, sexual immorality, as well as the sacrifices that were being offered to idols. And God gave her time. But the last thing we read in verse 21 is, so what? I don't really care. I'm very happy with what I'm doing. I'm getting all this attention. People are listening to me. I love being able to teach. I love being able to influence people. And we get that because she was a prophetess, a self-proclaimed prophetess. There's something dangerous about teaching. It feeds the ego. It gives some people a big head. And I think that's why James warns the brethren in James 3 that not everyone should become teachers, because there will be a stricter judgment. So for some, and I would take it, I would think that this affected Jezebel during this time. She was into her teaching. She loved the attention. People were following her. And she was caught up with sexual immorality and the meat that was going to the idols and getting even the church people to cave in to this kind of teaching. So no wonder why she couldn't repent. She had no ability to. Not that she can't, but she was so focused on the things that she was doing. So God gave her time to repent, but she said, "Nep, I'm content with what I'm currently getting," and that's dangerous. Rod?
Oh, okay. If Jezebel is a believer, mm-hmm. God gave her the time to repent, but she did not, is she saved?
Sure. I would say so.
Even though she did not repent?
Yes. Repentance is only for believers. So if you fail to repent, then what will happen is there will be discipline. So the discipline is progressive many times. Some 1 Corinthians 11, remember the people were just partaking in the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner. All they were doing was trying to get the food and just continue to have fun and disregarding what it stood for. And God through Paul said, you know the reason why some of you in the church are weak? You know why some of you are sickly? You know why some of you died prematurely? Because of this kind of behavior. So likewise, when there are people who are going to not repent, then God will take them out soon. So I'm sure, you know, we would sometimes look at things like this and say, was she really a believer? Well, you know, when you compare Scripture with Scripture, and that's why I said, for me, because the word repent is used, it's always connected to a believer. It's never, well, there's a few instances, but the majority of the time the word repent is used, it's towards the believers in Christ. So when a person stops or does not repent, what happens at that point? Does their relationship with God cease to exist?
Does he leave them to themselves?
Yeah, Romans 1 talks about how if you continue to suppress the truth, and depending on the context, like in here, God says, stop, I want you to repent. And she said, no, I like this. And God says, okay, if you continue to suppress the truth about who I am and what I've communicated to you, then I will give you over to yourself. And the sin is 1,000% aggressive, much more aggressive after that. Because there, initially there's a protective, almost like a protective bubble around us so that we don't destroy ourselves. But then when we just live in rebellion and we continue to suppress the truth, Romans 1 says eventually he turns us over to ourselves, and that's the worst thing you can do. Not facing the devil. Facing the devil is not the real problem. The real problem is self. I have to remember that. That's why I'm an advocate of constantly feeding on the Word of God. Because we need to develop and strengthen the inner man. The inner man is what's going to catapult us to make it tomorrow, the next day, the following day, and so on. And the tendency to sin is reduced over time as we feed the inner man. Just like we know, like what Emily's doing and what others are doing. When you reach a point in your life, you know that your health is dependent on the intake of your food, the quality of the food. All of a sudden, the Milky Ways and all of these milkshakes, they don't have the same appeal anymore. Because all of a sudden, you know, I'm tired of the headaches. I'm tired of having no energy during the day. And so what do you have to do? You have to do a radical shift. And it may not be... It may not be easy at first. You got to change things. You got to, you know, all of a sudden you got to watch your budget because the food costs a little more in some ways. You know, you got to cancel out on the drive-through McDonald's. You usually do this during lunch, and so now what am I going to do? Am I going to really eat this apple in lieu of this? But you know what? If you're tired of being tired, that's what you got to do. And some of you have. Physically speaking, you've done radical changes so that you can feel better about yourself. You feel more energetic. You have clarity of mind. You start remembering things. You're not as sick anymore. So if you understand that on a physical level, then you have to remember that when Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, that's important. And so as often as we eat, I believe it's as often as we should eat or consume spiritual food as well. Otherwise, we get clobbered because our old way of thinking is still in us. And the only way to curb or curtail those tendencies is through strength that comes from Him. And we know that to be God, the Holy Spirit. So to answer the question again, if she failed to repent, is she still a believer? Yes. We don't know if she repented later on. You see, so when some person doesn't repent today, does that mean they'll never repent later on? Remember the thief on the cross? One of them did. At the very last second. Nobody even knew that except Jesus and us. Somehow the Holy Spirit allowed us to have that kernel of truth. Everybody else was already gone. And so these three were supposed to die, and they came back to break the legs of the two criminals, except Jesus, because he was already dead. But we have an insight on what transpired between one of the thieves and Jesus Christ, and at the very last second, he responded. So, just like with anybody, right here in verse 21, the scripture says she did not repent. Does that mean she lost her salvation? No. Salvation, I don't believe, can be lost. I believe, if anything, she is going to be disciplined by God. In fact, we see that in the next verse, actually. Because of this, I will cast her into a sick bed. See, remember, notice what the steps he's taking to get her attention. God doesn't deal with unbelievers like this. He doesn't say, okay, if you do this, I'm gonna cause you pain. The only one that God interacts with is believers, those who are children of God, those who are a part of the family of God. But he never interacts with unbelievers. There might be an occasion with the hopes that he or she would respond favorably and recognize that God is real, but he doesn't spank them. He doesn't discipline them the way he would his children. So whom the Lord loves, he disciplines. And if you were there last week during the second hour, I elaborated more on the how God loves even the unbelievers, and the love itself breaks into two. Remember, there's a personal love which is directed towards those who are believers, and then there's an impersonal love where it doesn't matter what people do. You want to live in sin? It's up to you. I will still love you in an impersonal way, and the apex of it, and the demonstration, the apex of it all, was at the cross. So he loved unbelievers in an impersonal way, but that doesn't require them to have any kind of relationship with him. It just depends on his virtue. It depends on his integrity. And he's able to do that and pull it off without compromising who he is. So look at what 22 says. Let's zoom in on the word. Indeed, I will cast her into a sick bed. So an adulteress practices her occupation in bed. So again, it's kind of tough to really make sense of this. And as I was looking into the various resources that I have, it's hard to make sense of some of this. Jesus is going to cast her into a bed of pain. The place of sin becomes the place of discipline. Okay, so I will cast her into a sick bed. And so what some scholars have said is that this is where the sin is occurring is where the discipline is going to occur. So I will cast her into a sick bed. I will inflict pain. There will be suffering. And this is kind of the whom the Lord loves, I will spank, I will discipline. So in here, he's telling us through John that he is going to somehow cast her into this situation on her bed where she's going to be experiencing pain. So it's the place of discipline. So that's what we see here. That's what I've gathered as I've researched this. And think of the prodigal son. He reached a point, you know, he was with prostitutes. The brother was complaining, you'll recall. The brother was saying, you know, he spent his money on prostitutes and wasted his money on all these friends. And when we look prior to that, he gets to the point where the only thing he could put in his stomach is the food that he was instructed to feed to the swine. He was being paid to feed the swine. And, you know, he was hungry enough to want to consume that, but no one would give him anything. So even when you look closely at the text, God has everything under control so that there's maximum suffering, maximum pain. He was hungry. That got his attention. His friends abandoned him. That got his attention. Have you ever, you know how it is when you all of a sudden your friends or you're close with someone, all of a sudden they pull out like that? And maybe they were your friends for different reasons. Maybe you had money. Maybe you were always treating them. Maybe you were always taking them to places, and because you couldn't, you had to tighten it up a little bit, you have to watch your spending, they stop hanging out with you, they stop calling you, they stop checking up on you and seeing how you're doing. Well, that's what happened with the prodigal son. He took part of his inheritance, he went out, everybody followed it. Everybody wanted to be next to the prodigal son. Why? Not because he was a nice guy, without the money, But because he was a nice guy, because he was taking care of everybody, but the moment the money ran out, so did the friendship. See, when we look at these examples, God is leaving us all kinds of principles that are really contained, whether we're looking at how God is patient with this one woman and how he's patient with us, or reviewing the prodigal son, that God is going to even allow us to nearly starve so that he would eventually, or we would eventually say, I had it better when I was with my father. That's the picture there. That's the story there. So you go out, you think you know what you're doing, and you splurge, and you have all these friends, and God just puts his hand at this particular location. He says, tomorrow there's going to be a famine. And there's a shortage. There's a shortage. And it affected the son, who then said in his mind, by the way, when it says he was thinking in his mind that his father would not take him back as a son, that the word there, there's a word in there that's the same word for repent. He's reorienting to truth. He said, I had it better at my father's house. I know my father won't take me back as a son, but maybe as a hired servant. So he's strategizing. What can I tell my father? I need to go back there because there's food to eat. The servants have food to eat. All of a sudden, the basic necessity of food is a major thing for this guy. And he had it all when he was under the care of his father, but he chose to take matters into his own hands and leave because he did not want to be with the father. We don't know why, but it's a picture that God knew that we would be able to use in our own lives. So there would be this place of discipline. I will indeed cast her into a sick bed, and those who commit adultery with her into great tribulation. So those who go along with her false teaching, and even though Jezebel was teaching things contrary to sound doctrine, this does not mean that she was not saved. Again, to me, the word repent and the idea that God is involved and patient for her to repent indicates to me that she had a relationship with God. At this point, it has been severed. She is no longer consistent or with God and his word, but she decided to opt and do other things and distort the truth that she knows to be true. So is she still saved? Yes. Because there again, if we admit that we can sin for just a second, then we can sin for 10,000 years if we want to. Because time is just that, time. 1 second, 10,000 years, it doesn't matter. It's the same. So likewise, when a person commits sin, some stay in that sin, some get out of the sin, some take time before they get back into fellowship with God. Some, they get nailed on the cross, and then they believe right then and there, and then they make it the very last second. There's various scenarios. Very difficult to put our finger down and say, well, this person's saved, this person isn't saved, this person's saved, by the external. We can't tell by the external. If anything, we would be able to tell based on what they would say and based on what the scripture says when they attach certain words to the individual. So if the word repent is used, again, if you do a research and search for the word repent, you'll notice that it's tagged to a lot of the, I would say 98% of the time it's to the believer. And if it's to the unbeliever, it's very clear that he's not disciplining them. He's telling them to turn from their idols and turn to God. Because that way, they're now in a position to respond to the truth. But if they're not if they're not facing God, they're not facing truth, but they're facing false teachings, is very difficult for them to respond to truth. And so there's like a couple instances that share that kind of understanding of the word for the unbeliever. So those who go along with her false teaching, and those who, even though she was teaching those truths that were not really truth, but principles going against sound doctrine, this really doesn't mean or even prove that she was not saved. When you get to the tail end, unless they repent of their sin, so they would fall into this great tribulation, those here in 22, those who commit adultery with her, unless they repent of their deeds. So the idea here is that the same grace that he extended to Jezebel is now being extended to those who partook in this false teaching and the sexual immorality. You see the word those, they refer to the those right in the middle of 22. So if they repent of their deeds, then they're not going to suffer in that tribulation. They're not going to experience what Jezebel is going to experience. God is open to those who repent of false doctrine. Repentance averts God's discipline. So if we're falling, if we've fallen for false doctrine and false teaching, and I think we probably can, if we think long and hard, we know people who were in church before right next to us, and now they're swept into false teaching. Do you know people like that? Who are no longer a part of the evangelical churches, and they're now caught up with a cultic system or something like that. Does anybody know people like that? No? Okay. Well, I know a few. I have one who I know, a family member who married into someone who is involved with a cult. And I'll not name the cult, lest they're listening now and be affected by what I say. But this one person went from one system to another because this person fell in love with this other person who was a part of a cult. So she turned her back on what she grew up with and said, I'm now going to switch and follow my husband's teachings, and relocated so that he can continue to pursue further training in this cult. Emily?
What's the difference between cult and a cult?
Cult is polarized usually around one person who claims to be consistent with Scripture, but they usually mess up when it comes to Jesus Christ. So you take, for example, any cult out there, JW, Mormons, and so on, they all believe that they're a Christian. Oh, we believe in God. Oh, we believe in the Bible. They have their own writings that will also enhance what we are missing. But the problem is that you look closely at what they say about Jesus Christ, and that's where it falls apart. JWs, for example, believe that he's just really Michael the Archangel. Everybody in this room believes that Jesus Christ is God the Son, second person of the Trinity. They won't say that. They will say, well, Jesus is a mighty God, but he's not the almighty God. They'll take one word, mighty and almighty, two words, and that's a big difference. Almighty refers to the Father, and mighty refers to a lower God. Jesus is a lower God. See? A lesser God. Mormons believe that Jesus and Lucifer were spirit brothers. Believers in Christ believe that Jesus Christ is God the Son, second person of the Trinity, who created Lucifer. And in times past, he rebelled. He wanted to be like God. So we adhere to what the Word says, but their teachings after the Scripture usually add to what we currently have in our Bibles. So they have their own sacred writings. Jesus Christ came again and visited a particular group of people. And so instead of debating and arguing whether or not that actually happen. I always, it's so much easier to take them with the scripture and say, well, if the word says this and your newer writings say this, should we not default to that which we know to be true? I mean, you are using the Bible, you are using the King James Version of the Bible. They like the King James. So if you believe he spoke in the Old Testament, you believe he spoke in the New Testament, now you believe he wrote another book called the Book of Mormon, for example. Should we not test the latest writings with the writings that have stood the test of time? Why should we put this newer writing above and over those writings that we know to be from God? And what trips them up usually is when you remind them, remember, you guys use the Bible too. So apparently you believe it's authoritative. So there's a conflict. You say that there's many gods. You say that the men are going to become gods. The scripture says there's only one God, and that's I, the Lord God, and there's no God before me, no God after me. I, the Lord God, am one. And yet you are going to say that men become gods? So that's a cult. They claim to be that which is similar to Christianity, usually with an improvement because Jesus came later on and gave later writings. And the way to discount that is to test those later writings with what we know to be true. Occultism is different. It's usually dealing with the spiritual world, usually the demoniacs or the demons, the satanic world, the supernatural, those kind of things. And there's a growing interest in that kind of activity, whether we're talking about, you know, the TV shows that are going around and investigating the ghosts in certain houses. Some are easily explainable, others are not. And when you see those houses that are not easy to explain away, and you've got footage of things that have been proven to be legitimate, that just somehow there's no strings, there's every frame was inspected by, you know, people who have a background in knowing if it was falsified or tampered with. When you find those small percentages of houses that seem unexplainable, then it's possible we're dealing with the supernatural. And instead of calling it a ghost, it would probably be better to call it what it really is according to scripture, and it's probably fallen angels or demons. And so what they would do is they come as an angel of light, they will distract and discourage, they will get people to focus in on the house, they'll get people next door to be afraid to live next to that person. But you know, there's been a few instances, people from this class and others, and I'll remind them that the scripture says, greater is he that's in you than he that's in this world. So there might be some noise, you might hear things from time to time, but go directly to God. Lord, there he goes again. He's making too much noise. He's dragging a chain around the floor, and I have to work tomorrow. So could you please squelch that so that I can get some rest? I've told people to turn on the radio and play Christian music, you know, especially the hymns. They don't like it. They can't stand it. Usually the noise stops. So when there's an emphasis on Jesus Christ, the emphasis on the cross, you know, the music that has a lot of content from scripture seems to get the noises to come to a halt. And when that's the case, one, it's either coincidental, or two, maybe there's something going on. But I always tell people, don't assume it's supernatural. Always start with there is an explanation for this. Start with the physical. If you can't pinpoint it and if you've exhausted everything, then it's possible you might be dealing with something that might be of another dimension. And if that's the case, always remember that you have our Lord who is greater than whoever's in this world. And he takes residence in you. He's not going to share your temple with the devil. He owns you. You belong to him. And he's obligated to protect you. And you have a seal until the day of redemption, to the day of Christ Jesus. So you have nothing to worry about. So anyways, this is where we will stop. We will, again, we'll revisit this next week. The repenting of their deeds, and we'll just kind of pick up from there and see if we can add something else to that. Father, thank you, as always, for giving us the time where we can come together to look at your word. We know that this particular book is a special book indeed because it offers a promise that those who would read it and study it and apply it would be blessed. And so we're thankful, Lord, that we can have additional blessings as a result of just studying your word. This is the only book in the entire scripture which offers a promise such as that. So we're not doing it for the added blessing. We truly believe that we have been already blessed. And the fact that we are called children of God and that we have your life, we have your spirit resident in us is already plenty. It's beyond words. But Lord, we know that you probably want us to study this book so that we can be nurtured in sound doctrine, which will help us as we continue to live from day to day until we see you. So thank you, Father, for this time. We ask and pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.